Prime Minister Chris Hipkins is en route to Papua New Guinea for several meetings with Pacific leaders and a bilateral meeting with India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi. This year, India became the world's most populous country. It has a growing middle class. And with ongoing tensions between China and some of our oldest allies, many see India as a prime example of an export market with massive growth potential. Rahul Sen is a senior lecturer at AUT and a fellow at the New Zealand India Research Institute. Kia ora, good morning.
Kia ora, good morning, Jack.
So, India is now the world's most populous country. From an economic and geopolitical perspective, how do you see its place in the world in the coming decades?
Well, India is right now the fifth largest economy in the world, and it's likely to overtake Germany by 2026 if the way that it's growing, you know, it continues to grow like that. And it might well be the third largest economy by 2030. So it's growing at a phenomenal pace. A country of 1.4 billion people, estimated to grow at over 6% this year and probably faster over the coming years. So, you know, in terms of the economic importance, certainly, you know, India is becoming one of the biggest economies in the world. It's pretty much set to become one of the biggest economies in the world in the coming decades.
Yeah.
And certainly the center of geopolitical and geoeconomic activity is shifting to India, and I guess it will increasingly shift more to India in the next few years.
So how do you assess New Zealand's relationship with India as it stands right now?
Well, New Zealand's relationship with India, if I would put it in, you know, very shortly, in very few words, essentially is that, you know, we are pretty much not really at the level that we should be in terms of our engagement with India. India, I mean, if you look at the numbers, we are not even, India is not even among the top 10 trading partners of New Zealand and for quite some time. And in fact, over the last 5 years, our bilateral exports have fallen by $1 billion. So right. Clearly, in terms of the trading relationship, we have sort of fallen off the radar, if you look at it, with India over the last 5 years or so.
Why do you think that is, Rahul?
Oh, well, one of the key reasons is because I think the expectation a couple of years back is that we were going to get a free trade agreement, which will allow New Zealand businesses to get, you know, goods access, particularly looking at our key export markets, export businesses into India. But I think at that point of time, what wasn't realized is we were only looking at what, you know, what goods we can sell in India, but we were not really looking at what India can do for us and what we could do for the growth and development of India.
Right.
And I think that's one key point which has been sort of missed in terms of the relationship, that yeah. India is a bit of a different market. You know, you cannot just aim for selling goods and services. Yeah. You have to look at a long-term development partnership in terms of increasing investments.
Right. Yeah. See, that is very interesting. I want to compare New Zealand and its relationship with India with Australia's relationship with India. And Australia not only has a much closer trading relationship, but also potentially a closer cultural and geopolitical relationship. So, in fact, we've got some pictures recently of the Australian Prime Minister, Anthony Albanese, meeting with Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi there. I believe they are touring Narendra Modi Stadium. What is Australia doing that New Zealand should be doing?
Well, Australia, first of all, I think has a very clear early mover advantage here in the relationship with India. They had a very clear-cut 2035 India economic strategy. They exactly knew where to approach, which states to approach. They took a state-specific strategy. And I think that's really important for India because India is a huge market, there's huge diversity. You need to look at it in terms of its regional potential.
See, that is very interesting. Instead of looking at India as a singular country or as a monolithic block, it's actually very diverse.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's from there that they took the relationship to the next level. And one of the key reasons I think the Australia-India relationship is really also fostered is because both countries have realized that you need to have an economic risk diversification, particularly, you know, post-COVID. You cannot rely on one single trading partner so heavily. And I mean, I'll give you a very interesting example. If you look at India's trading partners, China is the second largest trading partner. But then India is trading, you know, as trading relationship is growing with Australia as well. Now, here in New Zealand, we are very much focused on our trading relationship with one single trading partner. Almost 30% of our trade is with one single trading partner. So, you know, there's a huge opportunity to diversify our economic risks here with India.
Absolutely.
And I think that's where we should be headed.
Let's just have a quick look at New Zealand's exports to India, broken down by sector. So we've got the numbers for 2022. And if you're watching at home, have a look at that. Run your eyes over the list. Now, keep in mind that given this is 2022, education doesn't feature as prominently as you might expect it to. But what else is missing? If you go through all of those exports, what is missing? It is, of course, dairy. What happens for New Zealand when it goes to India and says we want to expand our dairy exports?
I think from the Indian negotiator's point of view, if you look at, and coming back to your earlier question on, you know, what's Australia doing with India? So again, if you look at the Australia-India economic cooperation trade agreement, dairy is kind of out of scope at this moment.
Yeah.
But what has been achieved is that there is tariff, you know, there has been some tariff concessions on some very critical products for Australia's exports to India and likewise for India's exports to Australia. But the important part of it is there's a mobility partnership agreement which has been signed along with that. There is a professional working group which is looking towards movement of professionals. So basically getting the access to India's growing pool of skill and talent.
Right.
And that's something which I think we need to add on here. If we are very serious in terms of taking this relationship towards that trade agreement, and if I might say a comprehensive economic cooperation partnership.
Right.
So we are not talking about just a free trade agreement in terms of tariff concessions, but it's also going to be looking very much into trade and services, because that's where India has, you know, the potential.
Right.
And I think that's where the partnership opportunity lies for
the long
term.
So to be totally clear for people watching at home, Indian trade negotiators are very unlikely, in your view, to allow expanded access to New Zealand dairy exporters.
Well, if I may put it in this way, Fontra is already there in India, you know. There is a Dreamery line of products already in India where there's some partnership going on. And there can always be opportunities for technological partnership, which can improve the productivity. And I think that could be the starting point for looking at providing more access to, you know, New Zealand dairy
as
exporters.
As opposed to exporting milk solids, for example.
Because as I said before, the relationship has to start based on trust. Because in India, you know, a lot of businesses are family-based business. They're based on trust.
Yeah.
So you have to develop that trust that, you know, you're a reliable partner. You're not here to, you know, take away our competitive dairy products from us, and we can partner with you, we can grow with you, we can improve the productivity of our dairy products, our horticultural products. That's again another great example where New Zealand India partnership is. And I think once, you know, that trust is established, I see this as a pathway to that comprehensive economic cooperation agreement, which I believe we should see of New Zealand with India in the coming few years.
Periodically, rhetoric against Indians in New Zealand, particularly around migrant workers and international students, flares up. It can be ugly at times. Does the domestic politics of New Zealand influence how we are seen by India?
I think to some extent that might be true. Although, you know, as an economist, you know, I'm not in a position to actually comment on some of these sensitivities that are there. But one of the things that I would like to highlight, and this was reflected in a report a couple of years back, that Indians in New Zealand are contributing about $10 billion to the GDP.
Right.
We are 5% of the population. So, even when international students are coming in, they are ultimately contributing to our workforce. They are ultimately contributing to our skills and talent. And I think, that recognition needs to be there that, you know, Indians are, when we are looking at that mobility partnership, as I was talking about, and this was alluded to by Foreign Minister Jaishankar when he was here, India's Foreign Minister. I think that's the way forward, you know, to take this relationship to the next level, as you will.
I know that one thing that has concerned some observers is the progression of India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Some see him as an authoritarian figure or draw attention to the Hindu nationalist policies and philosophy held by many within his BJP party. Should that be a concern for New Zealand going forward?
I do not see that as a concern, simply because, in my view, I see Prime Minister Modi as a very decisive leader. His style of leadership is very decisive. If you want to get things done, it just gets done. You know, there are no delays, you know, in that plan or project. And if you look at the way that particularly India's economic development has happened, and just giving examples in terms of the infrastructure, it's just happening at a phenomenal pace. And I think this is where, and that's where I think, you know, the economic growth of India is going to take off with all this infrastructure that's happening around. And as, you know, I mentioned earlier as well, you know, New Zealand is a bit far behind in terms of looking at this phenomenal growth that's happening in India. And a lot of that is because of Prime Minister Modi. And if I might add to that as well, Prime Minister Modi, you know, has this unique way of communicating with his citizens, you know, in terms of what is his vision, what are the challenges that common men are facing. He talks to them directly through this program called Mann Ki Baat, which sort of comes every month. And through that, it's really interesting to observe that he has actually revived a lot of traditional Indian export sectors like handicrafts and traditional medicines and things like that. So I see him as a very decisive leader who has a vision for India to be taken forward in the next few decades. So I absolutely believe that from the New Zealand government perspective, if we are serious about having that long-term development partnership where, you know, we can do things in India and therefore we will, of course, in return, probably also get what we want from India.
Yeah. Hey, thank you very much. We really appreciate your time. I know there will be some people who take issue, perhaps, at your characterisation of Prime Minister Modi. We really appreciate your insights, Rahul.
Sure.
That is Rahul Sen. He's a senior lecturer at AUT and a fellow at the New Zealand India Research Institute.